There's one last question that we need to address before launching into the next module. We know that carbohydrates and fats are both important sources of calories in our diet, but they're also very different kinds of molecules. How is it possible for someone to eat lots of carbs, say lots of rice and pasta and bread, and have this result in weight gain through the addition of body fat? Conceptually, it would be easy enough to account for the conversion of dietary fats into body fat. You could hypothesize, for instance, that if you ate too much fat, the excess would simply be put into your body's own store of fat in adipose tissue. And as far as carbs are concerned, you know that our bodies have stores of a polysaccharide called glycogen in muscle and liver cells. So an excess of glucose in the bloodstream could be made into glycogen by regular dehydration synthesis. But on the subject of a person, or a doggy, getting chunky by eating lots of carbs, how could an excess of glucose be used to synthesize a molecule as different as a triglyceride? In order to answer this question, the best place to begin is to think about how we normally use triglycerides as the starting point for the fueling reactions that so far we have addressed only in the context of glucose metabolism. When you catabolize a fat molecule, specifically a triglyceride, and remember the structure of a triglyceride is a glycerol attached to three fatty acids, the first step is lipolysis, lipolysis, the splitting of a fat. Here's where the triglyceride is broken into the component glycerol and fatty acids. This typically happens in digestion, and the fatty acids are then taken up by the blood. A fatty acid, once it gets taken up by your cell, is taken into a mitochondrion more or less directly. That is, there's no glycolysis step, like in the metabolism of glucose. And in the mitochondrion, it undergoes beta oxidation, where the longest chains of fatty acids are broken into two carbon bits called acetyl coenzyme A, which are then taken up by the Krebs cycle. And from this point on, everything is exactly the same pathway as what we discussed earlier for the aerobic metabolism of glucose. I neglected to mention acetyl coenzyme A before, but now that we're talking about the molecular crossroads of carbohydrates and fats, we need to identify this as the place where the two catabolisms meet. The pyruvic acids produced by glycolysis are converted into acetyl coenzyme A, as are these fatty acids, as I just said. This is where you want to think about what happens when you eat more food molecules than you need. Let's say you've loaded all of these food molecules, glucoses and fatty acids, into your cell from your last meal, but you don't have a need to make that much ATP. Things are going to back up somewhere, right? So what happens is that all of that catabolic process keeps on chugging along until it gets to the point of acetyl coenzyme A, which then piles up. When there's this kind of overabundance of acetyl-CoA, the excess gets taken up by enzymes and synthesized into fatty acids. The fatty acids then get esterified or converted into triglycerides, which then get stored in your adipose tissue. So it doesn't matter whether the extra acetyl-CoA came originally from the dinner roll or the butter. It's going to become part of a fat molecule on you either way.